Okay, in this lecture, I would like to give you a presentation to introduce lithium-ion battery. So I'm Alexey Glushenkov, and I'm an associate professor at the Australian National University, where we also run some battery research. So what I'd like to show you is this. So this is my talk outline. I will first discuss certain applications of batteries. Some of those applications are quite traditional. Some of those applications are relatively new. And then I will shift to talking about lithium-ion batteries, and I will describe what they are and how they work. And finally, I will talk briefly about how you generally conduct battery materials research and development in coin cells. So first, let's look at applications of batteries. And I'm sure most of you use some of these applications, right? And of course, I shouldn't introduce what batteries generically are to this group, right? So you, of course, have them in different forms, in coin cells, in cylindrical form, in sort of this planar form for laptops, for example. And of course, everyone uses mobile phone nowadays or a laptop. So these devices are portable, and of course, they will be powered by batteries pretty much. In addition, batteries can be used in power tools, so that's stuff like that. And of course, if you have a car, that it's highly likely that any car you have will have some small battery inside to provide the start for the car and also to power all the electrical components and electronics in the inside of the car. But what changed recently, new, very exciting applications of batteries emerged. And if you think about those applications, there are three major streams. Of course, first, batteries now are used a lot in stabilization of power grid, especially in the situation where you have renewables being introduced in the grid. So things like solar installations and wind generators. You also currently use batteries a lot in residential applications globally. So this is something that you have perhaps at home. And if you have a photovoltaic panel on the roof, or in other words, solar cell, then sometimes it's a good idea to supplement this energy generator with a storage capability. Because in this way, you can also store energy in a battery when you don't need to use it immediately. And you can do a bit of shifting of energy, right? So you can generate energy in part of the day where it's windy or it's sunny, and you can later deploy energy from the battery when you need it, maybe in the night or in the time where intermittent renewable source is not available. And very interesting application. And this is really the application which is going to become probably the dominant for lithium-ion batteries specifically in the next couple of decades is the use in electric cars. So let me just give you a bit of additional information about some of these uses. So let's start from uses of batteries in the grid. And here I will just talk about mostly about Australian context. So in Australia, batteries became very trendy and useful in the grid since 2017. And the history of this is that before, in particularly in the location of South Australia, we had significant weather disruptions to the point where we had actually damaged transmission lines in South Australia. And what it caused, it destabilized the grid. And in that place, the grid has a lot of renewables inbuilt. And blackouts were introduced in the state. So to avoid these issues in the future, South Australia government put installed a battery in the state, and this was tendered to Tesla and completed in December 2017. This is quite big, 100 megawatts, 125 megawatt hours installation. And this system was a big success, and it's not only relevant to Australia, but also relevant to many other places in the world where this experience was taken on board, because after this battery was put in place, blackouts were avoided. It takes very little time to get online if needed, and it even can be profitable. So you can save costs if you use a battery in the grid, and you can also generate a bit of profit by power shifting, so you can choose where to use your energy. Since then, in Australia, we have a boom of this grid-related batteries. So currently, we have projects in South Australia, more projects. We have projects in the state of Victoria, where Melbourne is located. And myself, I'm based in Canberra, in Australian Capital Territory. And here, we also started introducing these new batteries. And this is of particular interest because our Australian Capital Territory is aiming to have 100% of electricity from renewable energy. So this type of installation completely makes sense in the local context. And the first system was announced a couple of years ago and currently in progress. And recently there were two new projects which are scheduled in the state to be pursued in the near future. Now, these grid-related batteries, just to give you context, they can be quite big, and in fact, they sort of become bigger and bigger. So I show you a couple of projects. This is a battery, but it's not a lithium-ion battery. It's a flow battery, vanadium flow battery, pursued in China. So this is another grid-related installation. However, note the energy and power capability of this battery, very significant, much higher than what I showed you before. And if you look at it, it's really a huge sort of undertaking. It's the size of a very substantial building, really. Another impressive installation is being undertaken in the United States, in California. So this is also a project where Tesla participates in one of the partners. And this is similarly big battery, and it's about 10 times bigger than the Australian battery I showed to you two slides back. Now, this project is about to be completed this year, but then it's already known that a significant upgrade of the project is scheduled. So from this, they're going to scale the battery 5 times again. So it's going to be much bigger in the future when this project is fully completed. Another interesting application, well, it's in some way related, but a bit different as well, because you use batteries at your home, right? So if you want to have partial electricity generation from the sun, you can have a solar cell on the roof, and you can also complement this with a battery at home. Australia is really a global leader in solar cell installations, probably within top two countries together with Germany in this aspect globally. And even now, more than 10% of electricity already generated in this manner in Australia, and 2 million homes are in fact energy producers, and not only consumers in Australia, actually not even now, but a year or two ago. Now, as I said, to complement a solar cell system, you can introduce residential batteries, right? And here on this slide, I have some examples. One example is a Tesla Powerwall system, which can be used for this purpose. There are many other systems, for example, this Chinese battery from Build Your Dreams company, BYD. And also it's good to know that the number of installation has been increasing in Australia. And a couple of years ago, one in 27 homes was estimated to have PV with a battery in Australia. So in the future, we expect that there will be more and more at-home installations, and this will be a common part of electricity grid in Australia. Another interesting innovation in this space is so-called community batteries, also known as neighborhood batteries. So the idea here is, instead of having a battery just in one household, in one house, you can introduce a shared battery that will be working as a battery for the whole area, right? For multiple households, maybe to as many as 20 houses. And indeed, it's convenient to introduce batteries like this when you, for example, develop a new residential area, right? You can fit it with a battery of this nature and use it for the benefit of all residents in the area. So currently we have multiple projects, probably about 10, happening nationwide in the space of this battery systems. Of course, it's a bigger item that you would put at home and you would keep it in a dedicated area outdoors, right, to service all the neighborhood. Right, and the final application, and this is really going to be very big in the future, is in electric vehicles. So on this slide, I have a few cars that you can currently purchase in Australian market. It's of course Tesla, but also electric cars available from many other traditional car manufacturers. For example, you can buy Hyundai Ioniq in electric version. You can buy BMW in electric version and many other cars. I'm sure that a similar trend will be emerging in Indonesia as well. Soon with local cars, or maybe also from overseas cars. Okay, now just some remarks on adoptions of electric cars. This has been uneven in different places, and I must admit that Australia is a bit slow. So we had a relatively small number of these cars sold at present, so less than 1% of new vehicles. And this forecasted to grow a little bit by 2023. Maybe if Bloomberg agency is correct, we're going to end up with something like 4% of sales by the time. However, this situation is quite different. So, for example, in the international context, you can see that Britain and France basically want to end sales of petrol cars for good by 2040. India also wants to follow a similar trend. And China also has a goal to have more than 20% by 2025. More than 20%, 45% of their cars to be EVs or plug-in vehicles. Of course, when we speak about electric vehicles, we're not necessarily talking about passengers vehicles only, but you may also consider that it makes sense to electrify other fleet as well. For example, you can electrify buses, and this is just a picture of an electric bus used in one of Australian airports. So I was also very pleased when I was last time in Jakarta airport that the electric sort of little cars running around the terminal, moving people around. So it's clearly happening in Indonesia as well. You can also use utility vehicles. For example, this is a mining vehicle, which can be used even underground. And one of Australian mining companies is trialing this utility vehicles for this purpose, underground mining application. And you can use cargo vehicles like this. So there is an inspiring Australian company that's trying to manufacture those locally at the moment. Okay, so this is what I wanted to mention about applications. However, if you think about which batteries are used currently, I'm sure you all know that the dominant battery type everywhere, pretty much in all the applications I mentioned, is lithium-ion batteries nowadays. And in fact, the technology is so good that even Nobel Prize was awarded in chemistry in this area a couple of years ago. So let's look a bit more into how these things work. And they operate on the so-called rocking chair principle, right? So I have some picture of rocking chair here. And if you have one of those, you know that the way this chair works is by moving forwards and backwards reversibly, right? So this is exactly what we are achieving in a lithium-ion battery. So this is my schematic of a discharge process in a lithium-ion battery. So when your lithium-ion battery is charged, you will have lithium ions sitting inside of one of the electrodes. And then when the discharge process happens, lithium ions will get out of this electrode into the electrolyte. And they will move to the opposite side of the battery, to the cathode, to the positive electrode, and they will insert themselves in that electrode. And importantly, each of these processes, lithium ions leaving negative electrode or lithium ion entering positive electrode, are in fact redox processes. And what it means that every time this happens, you also have electron released from one of them, which can travel to the opposite terminal. And if you have some useful circuit here, or light bulb, you can actually achieve conducting some useful work when those electrons move from left to right. Now, if you need to charge this battery, you of course need to connect a charger to it. And by doing this, you will reverse this process. So your electrons and lithium ions will move in the opposite direction. So electrons will therefore move back into a node, an external circuit. And lithium ions will exit cathode structure into electrolyte and will move to the opposite side and enter into the negative electrode. So this is sort of like a rocking chair in a sense that something moves back and forth in this system. Another example I would like to show you is this. So you can also think of this rocking chair mechanism as a badminton game, right? So I know badminton is a popular pastime in Indonesia. So this is kind of related concept because in here you have a shuttlecock, which is your lithium ion, right? And what shuttlecock will be doing, it will be moving from left side of the field to the right side of the field and then back, right? So this is exactly what lithium ions do in lithium ion battery, right? So it's easy visual concept to memorize perhaps how these things work. All right, another thing I would like to highlight is that we have this generic name lithium ion batteries, but in fact, this is not one system. This is many systems with the common name, right? And this is defined by which negative electrode materials and positive electrode materials you choose. So at the moment, a vast majority of lithium-ion batteries have graphite as a negative electrode, probably more than 95%, I would think. Sometimes lithium titanium oxide can be used. This is an interesting material because there was a question about hybrid capacitors. Actually, when the system was invented, hybrid capacitor in a high voltage configuration, LTO was the anode of choice that was tested in this application. Anyway, back to batteries. Now, there is also material silicon, which is currently under development. I'm not sure you can broadly buy them yet, but it feels like this is the technology which is coming very soon. It will help to increase the energy density of lithium-ion batteries. Now, on the positive side, you have a choice of a few different things. You have LTO, this is LCO, right? The typo here. Lithium cobalt oxide, lithium manganese oxide, LMO, lithium iron phosphate, also known as LFP, right? You have NMC and you have NCA over here. Now, if you sort of can use simple math, right? You can calculate how many combinations you can get and you can end up with 15 different batteries, right? Using these different materials. And importantly, depending on which pair you pick, you will end up with a different voltage, you will end up with different energy. Also reliability, safety, and speed of charge will change. So some of the systems will be fast to charge, some of them will be not so fast. Some of them will have more energy, some of them will have less energy. Importantly, when we talk about lithium-ion batteries, we need to also mention their electrolytes, because electrolyte is a part of the success in lithium-ion batteries. Now, the problem with traditional batteries is that they use aqueous electrolytes, and this is something that limits their voltage. So typical voltage in aqueous batteries is 1.2 volts, right? Sometimes you can increase it by using some special hybrid designs. This is maybe more typical for supercapacitor type of devices where you can boost it to 1.8 to 2 volts. But what happened in lithium-ion batteries is that for them, electrolytes which were organic in nature were developed. And this typically includes a mixture of cyclic and linear organic solvents. So you usually have EC, ethylene carbonate, as one of the solvent. And you may have one or combination of diethyl carbonate and dimethyl carbonate in the electrolyte. And the typical salt which you use in conjunction with those mixed solvents is lithium PF6. So this is a nice electrolyte because it can nicely work with many anode materials and with many cathode materials. And you can create cells which can operate at voltages up to 4.5 volts. Right. So it's a nice system that boosted the voltage of the battery and increased energy in the cell. Right, let's look at some common lithium-ion batteries. And I know Professor Evi had this included in her conversation, in her talk, but I would like to recap this a little bit. So one of the common system is graphite NMC. So as it follows from the name, you have graphite as a lead host and negative electrode. So graphite is a typical lead material where ions can move in between the planes. And you can create intercalation compounds. And when those intercalation compounds form, it's a redox process. In the positive side, you have this layered host that includes nickel, cobalt, and manganese in these layers. And in between those layers, lithium sites exist where lithium can be intercalated into and taken out of those locations. Now, when it's all combined in a cell, you have a very nice system where you will have high voltage, you will have a good specific energy. And generally, if you're after a small compact battery, maybe electric car or some other applications where a compact battery is important, this is probably a good, reasonable choice. But then some other things are perhaps not so fantastic, like specific power is good, but not great. Safety is good, but not great. Lifespan is also good, but not great. Right? So there are trade-offs between different metrics in a battery. You can also find a lot in the market now graphite LFP batteries. So here, negative host is the same. But in the positive host, you will have lithium iron phosphate, in fact, as cathode host. And this material has a structure with tunnels where lithium ions also can sit and can be extracted from and placed back into if needed. Now, another interesting consideration about this material is that this is a really nanotechnology kind of thing, because you must create this material small particles, and you also probably need to do some tricks to improve conductivity, either by coating this carbon or by introducing some dopants in the structure. Now, this battery also comes with its pros and cons. So if you compare it with an NMC battery, you may notice that specific energy is different. Specific energy is smaller here, but then there is a clearly win in terms of lifespan. So if you have one of those, they will probably be going and going. And you also have an advantage in safety in these batteries. Okay, another battery type I would like to sort of mention by name, perhaps, is batteries that employ making too many types. Sorry, this is not graphite, right? So this can be anything on the positive side, on lithium, titanium oxide, LTO, on the negative side. So LTO is a material with this stoichiometry, which can uptake three lithiums and three electrons reversibly. Now, importantly, this is a zero volume change material, so it will not experience volume change as you cycle it, right? And volume change is not good for your material, because sometimes materials break just because of structural failure over time. And in addition, there is good speed characteristics in this material. Some examples of batteries that use this material, and most prominent one is a so-called supercharged ion battery by Toshiba. So they can be charged quite fast. So some LTO-based materials, LTO-based batteries, they are able to achieve high speeds of charge and can be used for fast charge applications. Now, just to provide a bit of practical angle and practical context, let's think of these batteries in terms of their application in residential batteries, right? So let's say we look at Tesla battery with NMC chemistry and BYD battery with LFP chemistry. So you can buy them both on market and you can use both of them, but then you would have typical advantages and disadvantages. So you will have, obviously with NMC battery, you will have smaller mass and footprint. It will be very compact battery with high energy density. That's the advantage. Now, lifetime perhaps is not gonna be super great. It's gonna be shorter than alternatives. If you use LFP type batteries, you can generally have bigger battery because battery cannot be as compact anymore just due to the limitations of its choice of materials. But you will have superior safety and longer lifetime in this case. Finally, I would like to mention silicon. So this is a strong trend currently in industry. It's been in development for quite some time, so it's clearly has its own challenges. However, still we have quite a lot of companies pursuing this with interest. And the thing about silicon is that silicon has absolutely dramatic capacities theoretically, up to 4,200 milliampere hours per gram. Compare this with capacity of graphite, which is about 10 times smaller. And this drastic change is achieved due to different storage mechanism, right? So instead of intercalation in graphite, you will have a process called electrochemical alloying with silicon. And due to this very different process, you can get much higher capacities achievable. So some of the excitement around these materials shown on the slide. So I just collected a few recent media reports. And you can see that a part of the industry is quite excited about this. And even considering reusing silicon from waste, for example, you can try to recycle it from used solar cells, where silicon is the main component. All right, finally, I would like to discuss basic battery materials research and development a little bit. And I'll start from introducing this common cell types for you. So let's look at coin cells, right? Something you saw in computer motherboards and watches. And cylindrical cells, something also very very popular for various applications. Now you can see that in both cases, it's sort of similar in design because the internal structure conceptually is not different, right? So you'll have a negative electrode, this blue sheet here. You will have positive electrode cathode. You will have separator with electrolyte in between. Now, the difference is that in a cylindrical battery, you will take this assembly and you will create a roll out of it or a scroll. So you will sort of create this rotating structure. And by doing this, you can create a pack of electrode pair where you can put quite a lot of energy in the individual cell. Now, coin cells are simpler because in coin cells, you only have two simple electrodes, right? So you don't have any rolls. You have one piece of foil coated with negative active material, and you will have another piece of foil coated with positive material over here. But again, conceptually, this is the same because you will have separator and electrolyte in between. And the rest of the components are just there to compact the cell and to create internal contact in the cell. Now, I'd like also to dwell a little bit to explain the connection between these individual cells and big batteries, right? Some of those big batteries are huge, as you saw, but we also know that individual cell has limitations. For example, individual cell can only have up to about 4 or 4.5 volts in it, maybe even something like 3.4 for LFP cell. So how do you create a battery which will generate high currents and also have high voltage? So the answer is simple. You will need to create a big pack of those batteries so you can connect them either in series or parallel to create something like this. And sometimes you can also introduce maybe some cooling solution as well if you're concerned about overheating of the pack. So here I have a few simple battery pack topologies and we can see what we can do with individual cells. So in case if you need to boost the voltage of the pack, you will connect this in series, right? So you will put a sort of battery on top of each other, right? And by using this simple example, you can triple the voltage. Or you can combine batteries in parallel like this. And by doing this, you could also increase the current you can draw out of battery because on discharge, you have now a pair of batteries working in parallel. Okay, coming back to the R&D in the lab, so what you will need to do to use in the lab, one major item, if you don't have a dry room, So you need to have a glove box in this case. So typically the systems that isolate argon gas inside are needed to prevent moisture and oxygen getting in touch with battery cell. And moisture is in particular is problematic. Many components are sensitive to it. So this is the must for a battery R&D in the lab. And inside of the box like this, you will need to have a coin cell crimping machine. So this is a special unit that will reliably seal coin cells for you and to make sure, will make sure that you can fabricate batteries in your laboratory. Of course, you will need means to test the batteries. So for this, we use either battery testers or we use potential stat galvanostats. The difference is battery tester is usually simpler systems where it can only do charge discharge. So you can apply positive currents and negative currents to charge and discharge the batteries. You can also apply constant current, constant voltage sequences possibly. But that's about it. So if you need anything more sophisticated, you wouldn't be able to do it in those instruments. Instead, if you need to do a deep electrochemistry or something non-standard, you may want to choose potential stat galvanostat. These systems are usually set for performing very different electrochemical experiments, which may be useful for battery characterization in many cases. And these potential stats, they can be multi-channel like this and sort of static, like you put it on the bench and use, or they can be also portable, so it can be something small, maybe single channel that you can carry around and use in different locations where you need to. And just sort of to give this characterization a face, we can also see how you sort of connect coin cells, and obviously on these wires they would connect to systems like that to perform testing of batteries. Now, the current well-established standard in battery materials research and development is using coin cells. Now, although this is not the only way, right? You can use different things. You can use swage lock format as well. You can use re-electrode cells. Sometimes you can use in situ characterization cells, stuff like this. But most commonly, this is now done in coin cells. And of course, this makes sense because this is a simple battery setup, which is reproducible and can be assembled without much effort. And as discussed, the content of these cells is pretty simple, right? So you have a pair of electrodes, and if you use half cells to test individual electrodes, one of those electrodes is, of course, lithium foil. We test everything versus lithium in this instance. You will place separate an electrolyte in between. You will place additional components like spacer and spring, and you will use coin cell lead and base at the bottom and the top. And you will put it together and press it so it seals and creates a battery with good contact in between. Of course, don't forget to include the electrolyte in between. Right, if we zoom in the structure of individual electrodes, we can also see that they are typically multi-component systems, right? So here, let's say this is our hypothetical cathode material, and we're looking at a cross-sectional SEM image of it, right? So for those of you who don't use SEM too much, I can explain this image a little bit. So whatever you have brighter contrast here, this whitish stuff, are active material particles, right? So we have three ingredients in electrodes. We have active material, we have conductive carbon additive, and we have a binder as well. The binder is basically a glue to hold the structure together. And here you can see active material, those round particles. And in between them, you have a bit of a grayish sort of stuff as well. So this is conductive carbon, which is introduced there to improve conductivity of the electrode, and a binder, which is used to hold it all together. Typically, in the fabrication of electrodes, we start from making a slurry, so we will grind those materials together in a suitable solvent. So you might use solvents like NMP for PVDF binder, or you can use water for things like CMC binder. And you end up with a mass like this, which is easily spreadable on the electrodes, right? So of course, in good laboratory settings or semi-industrial settings, you can use something like Dr. Blade to apply this on the current collector. And you can create a nice coating with a thickness of a few tens of microns. After you dry this in a vacuum oven, you will end up with a neat electrode that looks like this. And those electrodes, sometimes it's beneficial also to calender them or to roll them through a rolling press. And this has multiple functions. It might provide better conductivity for your electrode. And also, it might be practically useful to reduce porosity in the electrode. And finally, you want to create electrodes which are fit for your particular type of cells. So if you use coin cells, you want naturally to cut them into circles of the size that fits the size of the coin cell format you are using. So this is nicely done with a punch or some kind of specialized electrode cutter in the lab. And after this is all done, you get to this assembly stage where you, of course, move to a glove box. It all happens inside of the glove box where electrolyte lives permanently. And what you do, you put all these things together. So as I said, there is a working electrode you test. There is a reference, which is lithium plate, lithium foil. But also, if you use sodium research, it can be sodium metal if you research on sodium batteries. And you put the stuff together, you introduce springs and spacer, and then you utilize coin cell crimping tool to squeeze it all and to seal the bottom and top cups of the battery. After this, it's sealed and safe, and you can take it outside and put it to test. Okay, this is the end of my talk. In summary, I hope that I was able to show you that batteries are actively entering new applications now. And these applications, of course, include electric cars, grid storage, and home storage. In these applications, lithium-ion batteries are truly state-of-the-art systems at present. In their operation, they use an interesting rocking chair or badminton operating mechanism. And these batteries also can be customizable by the choice of their components, particular electrode materials, to achieve different levels of energy, cyclic life, charging speed, and cell voltage. And finally, I sort of outlined basic requirements that you need to have practically in your laboratory to be able to undertake better research and development. And I'm sure there will be more content on this in this school later. Thank you very much for your attention. Terima kasih.